Alrighty, faithful ministry, God bless you all. Today we will be in Romans chapter 6. And in the NIV version, it says dead to sin and alive in Christ. So technically what we're going to be talking about today is sin, right? What is sin? Being dead to it, and you know, kind of talking about baptism and just like, you know, early Christian, like being early in your walk as a Christian and how to understand what sin is and fleeing from it and everything like that. Yes, I got you. I think I can. Let me see. Okay, oh, it's still going back. Did it zoom in? I don't know. Let's set it. Let me see. I don't think I can. Dang, is it kind of blurry, huh?
That made everything smaller.
That did?
Yes.
What? Yeah, I think you zoomed out.
Nah, I said I zoomed. Oh, wait, wait, is that good?
Yes, there we go.
Okay, what the heck? I zoomed in, it was like, instead of zoomed in 180%, zoomed out. All right, we straight. We good. So y'all can see it, we good.
Yeah.
Be good. All right, so first things first, y'all. I want to honor my guy, Kevin Gates, my guy. He's given into the ministry. He's my first one to give into the ministry. And it was just like amazing because I didn't even ask him, right? So y'all know that we was going to get it together and get this premium Zoom so that we don't have to have a time limit, right? Not today, we're going to have a time limit, but that's okay, though, because my guy Gates is giving into the ministry and helping me out to pray to pay for it. So thank God for Kevin. I just wanted to read this in honor of him. W. Gates, bro. W. Gates. Hey, put W. Gates in the chat. Clap him up for one time. Thank you, bro. Thank you.
No, thank you. Thank you.
And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6, it says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So this is what Gates did. He gave what he decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly, not out of compulsion, not out of peer pressure, but he did it just for the ministry. So thank God for my guy, Gates. The Bible says that if you sow sparingly, which is giving, you will also reap, which is receiving. So Gates, as you're giving, you will be receiving from God. Trust me, you're going to see stuff just start happening. You start giving, and God's going to start giving it right back to you. Hey, man. All right, y'all. Let's get right into it. Let's not waste no more time. Let's all go to Romans chapter 6. Let's look at what the Bible has to say. So let's get right into it. Let's just jump right in. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? It says, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Man, like I always say, let's break this down, y'all. Let's break it down. So this is Romans. This is the Apostle Paul's first official letter writing to the church in Rome. And, you know, this is while he was on his missionary journey, going through all out Asia Minor and everything. And, you know, just being an apostle, doing the Lord's work. And this is what he wrote back to that church. And in Romans chapter 6, he's really just honing in on sin. So I like how he says that in the beginning, right? In verse 1, he says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? And he says, by no means, right? And what he means by that is what we will see later on is because he will talk about us not being in the law, not under the law, but under grace. And what is grace? It's a gift. It's a free gift that you do not deserve, that you did not earn. Grace is something that is just given to you. You didn't do anything. It was just given to you. And that was the grace of Jesus Christ dying for your sins. That's what he's talking about here. So when he's saying, shall we go on sinning because the grace of God, because Jesus has died for us, right? He says, no. You don't just continue to go into sin. You don't continue to do the same things that you used to do, right? He says, like in verse 4 or in verse 3, right? Or do you not know that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus? We're baptized into his death, right? We died with Christ when we were baptized. So this is talking about water baptism, because in the Bible, in the book of Acts, it talks about, and in the Gospels, it also talks about that baptism of water, or John's baptism, John the Baptist. That was the baptism for the remission of your sins. So you have two different baptisms in the Bible. You have the water baptism, which is to forgive your sins, right? And it's an outward expression that I'm giving my life to Christ. And the baptism of the Holy Spirit is when the Holy Spirit enters you. Now he lives inside of you, and he's leading you, as the Bible says, leading you to all truth. He's your comforter. He's with you to help you to resist sin and things of that nature, right? So in this context, he's talking about the water baptism. So when you go down into the water, that's you dying. So like they say, dying with Christ and rising with Christ will take you out. So when you go down into the water, being fully immersed, that's what baptism means, fully immersed. You're dying to your old self. You're dying to your old ways, dying to the old things that you used to do. And when you rise up out of the water, that's saying that's the signification of being risen with Christ from death to life, right? Just as it says in verse 4, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life, right? The new life. So then again, right there, this is when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus, which was one of the Pharisees, and he came to Jesus and was asking questions. Right? What can I do to be saved? And Jesus says, you must be born again. Dying to your old self and being born again. This is the new life that he talks about right here. We too may live a new life. Right? Being born again, dying to your old ways. This is why it doesn't matter what you've done before Christ. So many people say this all the time, that I can't go to Christ until I get it all together, or I've done too much. There's no way God's going to accept me. I've done too much wrong, or I need to get clean before I can go to Christ. But that's the wrong mindset to have, and that's the enemy playing with you and placing that mindset in you to keep you from Christ, because Christ is the one that gives you new life. Christ is the one that cleans you. Christ is the one that you go to for the remission of your sins. So it doesn't matter what you've done in the past. You go to Christ to be cleaned up. This is what church is for. This is what Bible study is for. This is what having a congregation. This is what being in fellowship with people, praying and reading your Bible on your own, individual and in corporate. This is the whole reason of that. So that you can be cleansed and washed again. So that you can enter into the new life. And even when you enter into the new life, you will mess up 100%. Just like the Bible says, a man is a liar if they say they've never sinned. You're a liar. Everybody has sinned, but God, the grace of God. If you continue to go to God, he will cleanse you. And I always like to talk about David, King David. He messed up so much. You know, he literally took a man's wife, committed adultery with her, and then sent her husband to the front lines of war to be killed, so that he wouldn't find out about what happened. And then he ended up getting her pregnant, which created King Solomon. So that's how King Solomon came along with through Bathsheba. That's what I'm talking about. And yet he did this wrong, and he did a lot of other things, right? He had a lot of blood on his hands. He was a king, so he went into war. But the war wasn't wrong, so let's not talk about that. But let's just focus on the Bathsheba. So he took Bathsheba, committed adultery with her, took her from her husband, had her husband killed, had a baby with her, and everything. And yet God still said that this was a man after his own heart. So how can somebody mess up that bad and still be a man after God's own heart? It's simply because of his heart posture. It's all about your heart posture. Are you focusing on God? Even when you mess up, are you still going towards the mark? Are you still pressing forward? Even if I do sin, even if I do mess up, even if I continue to do the same sin over and over and over again, is my heart posture to please God? That's what it means to be a man after God's own heart. He was going after God. He was thirsting for God. When you read the Psalms, you will see that. He says, I thirst for you, Lord. I long for you. Right? And if you read Psalms 51, I encourage us all, read Psalms 51, because this is David's repentance before God about Bathsheba, what he did. And he says in verse 10, created me a clean heart, O God, and renewing me a steadfast spirit. Do not take your Holy Spirit with him. He's crying out to God. This is the man after God's own heart. Because even when he messed up, he was still able to humble himself, get down on his knees, humble himself before the Lord, and say, God, forgive me. I repent. Create in me a clean heart. Do it in me, Lord. Take this away from me. Take away the guilt. Take away the shame. So it's like, even in the new life, you're going to mess up. You're going to sin. But we do not practice it. That's the difference. Because when you were in the world, you practiced it, and you didn't have any conviction in your heart about what you were doing. You were able to do whatever you wanted. No conviction. But in Christ, you can still do whatever you want, but the Holy Spirit will convict you so hard that it'll keep you from doing those things, and it'll keep you consecrated to the Lord. My God. Hey, that was the Holy Spirit talking right there. Whew. All right. Hey, let's get back into it, y'all. We in verse 5. My God. Hey, but verse 5, it says, for if we have been united with him in death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. When you were in the world, you were a slave to sin. There's no conviction. You don't see anything wrong with it. You just continue to do the same thing over and over and over. You continue to follow the ways of the world, whatever the world is doing, whatever they see, whatever is deemed cool in society, whatever they say is cool, whatever they say is right, whatever they say is just, that's what you do. And you don't do what God says is right. You don't do what God says is just. But when you die to your old self, you die to your old ways, you crucify the old self, as it says right here. Crucify our old self and our old ways with Jesus so that our body ruled by sin might be done away with. My God. So that you're no longer a slave to sin, but that you're free from that. You're free from the bondage of sin and death. Because sin, like the Bible says, sin leads to death, which is separation from God. You will be separated from God on this earth, and you will be separated from God in the afterlife, which is hell. But if you give your life to the Lord Jesus, if you go all in for the Lord, if you say, God, I believe in you, I want you, please come into my life, change me, God. I understand that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And Jesus, you're the only one, you're the only way, you're the only truth, you're the only life, and you're the only way that I can go to. You're the only one I can go to for the remission of my sins. When you make that declaration and you say, God, forgive me, wash me clean, make me whole again, then you're saved. You don't have to worry about hell. You don't have to worry about that because that's not your portion anymore. Now you're saved. And when you continue, because this is a continuation, the Bible says, work out your salvation. Continue. Work it out. Labor. Labor in the Lord. You, hell is not your portion, but you will make it to heaven. And ultimately, the new heaven and the new earth. Amen. Verse 8 says, now if we die with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. That's so interesting. And thank you, Holy Spirit. The death he died to sin once and for all. Once and for all. In the Old Testament, they had to sacrifice the perfect lamb, the perfect lambs, right? No spot, no blemish, no nothing. They had to sacrifice the lamb for the remission of sins. But that death of that lamb was not sufficient. But the perfect lamb, the sinless lamb, Jesus Christ, the death he died to sin once and for all. And then death has no longer has any rule over him. Verse 11 says, in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. I'm going to read that one more time. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, separated from sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Now you're connected back to God. To be alive is to be connected back to God in Christ Jesus. So this is that Trinity that we're talking about here. We all have heard of that word, the Trinity. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now we're seeing this here. You're dead to sin, but alive to God. There we go, the first one. In Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. That's the second part of the Trinity. But how do we even get connected and saved like that? Through the ownership of the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit owning you, having ownership over you. Trinity right there. You're alive to God in Christ Jesus by the Holy Spirit. My God. Verse 12 says, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any parts of yourself or any parts of your body to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. This is the part I was talking about earlier. You're not under the law, but under grace. That's what I was talking about earlier. But I love that he says, don't let sin reign in your mortal bodies. Don't let it reign. Don't let it have jurisdiction in you, that you obey its evil desires. How to know that you've had a true encounter with God is when those sinful habits and those sinful things and those sinful acts that you used to do in the world is when you no longer have the desire to do it. Or even if you still have that desire to do it and it's still pulling you, you don't want to do it. You don't even want to do it. That's how you know you've had a true encounter with God. That's how you know you died to your old self and been made new in Christ. Even the old things you used to do, you don't even want to do them no more. But some things might stick with you. 100%. Some things just might stick with you. So when you come to Christ, it just depends on your walk. I've seen it. There's some people who come to Christ that have been delivered from everything. People who come into Christ addicted to this and that and was doing this and that. You put the puzzles together. They were doing a bunch of stuff. But when they came to Christ, all of that went away. But some people, like myself, you came into Christ and a lot of things went away, but some things God made you work through first. Some things God made you labor through to overcome it. But it's still all by his power. My God. But I love how verse 13 here says, do not offer any of your parts, no part of yourself, no part of your body as instruments of sin and wickedness. Rather, offer them to God. Your body, your temple, the body is a temple of the Holy Spirit that he dwells in. Offer yourself as an instrument in God to be used by God. Don't be used by the enemy to do the things of this world. We know what the things of this world are. But rather, be led by God and let him use your body and let him use you as a whole to do the work that he has called you to do. Amen. Give me a thumbs up, a hand clap, or something in the chat, y'all. Let me know y'all still here and y'all enjoying the study. Amen, 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 amen. Amen. Let's continue, let's continue, let's continue. Okay, good. That's the end of it, too. So we're going to go from 15 to 23, and then we'll be done, y'all. And then next week, we're going to get into chapter 7. And I'm going to explain at the end, too, why I chose to do this. Six, we're going to go through 6, 7, 8. Slaves to righteousness. Slave, servant, all the same word, right? Verse 15 says, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. So here again, he says it again. He says it again. So now he's really trying to hone in. Whenever the Bible repeats itself, he's trying to make sure that you understand that what I'm saying is serious. What I'm saying is what I'm trying to get across, right? This is when the Bible says it, like, sometimes you'll see that, especially in Paul's writings, where he will repeat himself. He will say the same exact thing he just said a few verses up, right? To make sure that you understand that he's getting his point across of what he is trying to say. So it says, what then shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. So he's asking a question, a rhetorical question. He's like, don't you know? Do you not know? Right? When you offer yourself as a slave or a servant to sin, that leads to death. But if you are obedient and a servant unto the Lord, that leads to righteousness. And righteousness means right standing with God, which then again is through Christ Jesus. The Bible said, Christ has made us righteous. He has made us in right standing with God. Because when you're in the world, you are not in right standing with God because you are separated from him. But with Jesus Christ, being connected to the Lord, you are made righteous. You are now in right standing with the Father. Amen. Verse 17 says, but thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness, or servants of righteousness. So one powerful, powerful quote that I heard was from this guy named Ty Jackson. I used to watch him on TikTok. And he said, and I was going through a similar thing, and I still struggle with this to this day, honestly, but trying to be perfect, trying to be a perfect Christian. And he was talking in his video, and he was saying that when he first became a Christian, his early walks as a Christian, that he would try to do the same thing, try to be perfect. And he said that every time he tried to be perfect and not sin and beat himself up every time he messed up, that he seemed to mess up even more. And he said that the Lord has spoken unto him and said that, stop trying to be perfect. He said, just obey me. He said, and in your obedience, I will perfect you. And when I first heard, I thought I understood it. I thought I did. But it took me until I was dealing with it, dealing with the pattern of sin, dealing with trying to be perfect and still falling. It took until I was in that moment and had my own experience with it that I completely understood what he was saying. This is why in the Bible says, when you have come to obey from your heart the patterns of the teaching you have claimed your allegiance to. When you obey God, when you're in obedience to God, which leads to righteousness. To be obedient to God is being that instrument of righteousness, to be used by God. That's that obedience. When God tells you to do something, you do. And I've gotten to that point. I've gotten to that point in my life before where God will tell me to do something and I won't, because I think I'm not qualified, because I sinned, because I messed up, and I'm trying to be perfect on my own. And then I will stop the move of God through my life because I'm beating myself up. And it's just like, when I went through that, God put that back into my head. Like the Bible says, the Holy Spirit will bring into you remembrance. He will remind you of the things that you've learned. And he reminded me of what I learned. And I was like, wow. God, I need to be obedient to you even if I mess up. Still do what you called me to do. Even if I do mess up, even if I do sin, you still called me to do a work. You're still speaking to me to do something. So let me do it. Let me go ahead and go forth to do what you called me to do. Let me not beat myself up. Let me not push myself down. Let me not stop the move of God through me and not obey him because I messed up. And then I had to humble myself and remind myself that I won't ever be qualified, because I'm not the one who qualifies myself. If I were to qualify myself, I would never be qualified to do the work of the Lord. But he is the one that qualifies. If he calls you, he qualifies you. If you are saved, he qualifies you. Whoever he calls, he will qualify. And I had to learn that. So now I took that quote and I fully understood it. That stop trying to be perfect, but just obey God. Because even when I sin, I will obey you. Because when I'm obeying you, even that sin that I did will no longer have effect on me. Because I did what you called me to do. I did what you called me to do. And that sin will be wiped away from me. And if I continue to obey you, then the sin that I once did, I will no longer have a desire to do it. And I will leave it alone, because now I'm doing what you have called me to do. My God, give me a clap, a hand clap, or something. I hope that made sense. Let me know if that made sense to y'all. Amen. Amen. All right, y'all, let's finish this out. Verse 19 through 23. Paul goes on to say, he says, I am using an example from everyday life because of your human limitations. Just as you used to offer yourselves as slaves to impurity, into ever increasing wickedness, so now offer yourselves as slaves to righteousness, leading to holiness. So Paul explains what he's doing, right? He's using an example from everyday life at the time, right? At the time, because of your human limitations, right? So he's basically saying, I could go into some deep spiritual things or something like that, whatever, right? But because of your human limitations, I will talk to you about everyday life. And the word slave there during that time, this was not talking about slavery as we know it or as we understand it. They were doing service unto people. If they owed somebody, that they would be their slave, or, you know, if they were just their servant, that's what that also meant, right? But the Bible talks about how a slave should be to their master, how a master should treat their slaves. So let's just get that under wraps. This is what he's talking about. That was during that time of the Bible, right? So this is not talking about now. So we always, when we're reading the Bible, we always must consider the historical value of it and understand that when they're talking, they're not speaking of 2023. They're speaking of like 60 BC, 60 AD or something, you know, like that's what they're talking. That's when they're alive. But verse 20 says, when we were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. But then he said, what benefit did you reap at the time from the things you are now ashamed of? My God. He said, those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. I love that. So what did you benefit from the things you are now ashamed of that you did in the world? When you were free from the control of God, when you were free from the rules and the laws that God has set up, when you were free from those things, but that had a price, which was death, separation from God. But he said, now you're free from it. You're free from sin. You have become slaves of God. The benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. Amen. My God, I thank you all for this time and hearing what God has placed on my heart to teach. For a lot of us that are early Christians or just young people in general, we got a lot of distractions, a lot of distractions. And there's a lot of different ways nowadays, especially to fall into sin. My God, so many different ways, so many different access points. There's just so much thrown at us, right? We're in this culture that is just hypersexual and everything is at your fingertips. So there's so many more ways to sin. There's so many more ways to go against God nowadays than there's ever been because of this, a phone and technology, bro. And the move of the devil, because he's just continuing to move through this earth in the most wild way. But God is way more powerful than the devil. And he will always, always overcome the devil because he already did. As soon as he kicked the devil out of heaven, he already overcame him. And then Jesus went on to overcome him even more by taking away the sting of death by dying on the cross for our sins. But I encourage you all, and for the next few weeks, we'll be going through Romans 6, well, we just got done with 6, but 7 and chapter 8. And this will teach you about sin like today and how we're not in it anymore. Chapter 7 is just one of the most authentic writings of Paul that I've probably ever read or just know about, because he really just talks about his struggle. And then chapter 8 is just the good news that Christ has set us free. But I'm going to go ahead and pray this out and we can go on with our day. So with bowed heads and pointed hearts to the Lord, Father, I thank you for this time, God. I thank you that we were able to learn more about you, Lord. You are amazing, God. Father, I pray that you would just wash us clean of all sin and iniquity, Lord, and that you would create in us a clean heart and a pure heart for you, God. Father, I pray that you would teach us how to continue to obey you so that you will perfect us and that we would never try to have perfection put on ourselves, but that our perfection will be found in our obedience unto you. And Father, I pray that you would seal us all in your Holy Spirit. I pray that you would touch each of us individually, Lord. I pray that you would encounter us in a new way, God, so that we would know you in a new way, God. That we would see a new part of you, Lord, that we have never seen before. That we would know more of your love and your mercy and your kindness, Lord, towards us. And that we would know how you think towards us and your thoughts towards us. And Father, we just thank you and we praise you. And we lift your holy name in Jesus' mighty name. Thank God. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. I hope you all enjoyed. And I will see y'all next week. My guy, Kevin. God's got a big blessing for you, my guy. But I'll let you know when we get this thing paid for, which will be next week. But I'll hit you up, my guy. I'll hit you up. All righty, y'all. God bless y'all. See y'all next week.